Bonjour Salman Rushdie.
Hello, how are you?
Ça va très bien, et vous surtout? C'est la question que tout le monde se pose. Comment allez-vous?
As you see, I'm okay, you know. I mean, I wasn't, but I'm better now.
This attack, just a year ago, what did it change in your life as a person?
Well, obviously there's a physical problem, you know, and it's taken a long time to recover from the injuries. But now, with the exception of the eye, which will not recover, it's mostly fixed, you know. And so that was one big change. And I think the only really concrete change is that I don't think it's going to be a little while before I go and stand up in front of an audience again, you know. Because, you know, Chautauqua is a very peaceful place. The audience is a very liberal, progressive, sweet audience, you know. And of all the places in America, it's the last place where you would expect an act of violence of this kind to take place. You know, I'm a person who looks forward, not backwards. And that's always been my way of dealing with whatever problems life may throw at you, you know. So I'm more interested in tomorrow than yesterday. I try not to spend too much of my time thinking about what happened a year ago.
Just between you and me, did you feel supported when it happened? Did you expect more from the literary world, from intellectuals, even readers all around the world?
What I felt was this enormous wave of friendship and support and outrage from all over the world, you know, and it was very moving, you know, and very moving to me and my family, you know, and strengthening, you know, to feel that amount of support. And so, yeah, I'm very grateful for it. And I know that President Macron said some very powerful words, and I'm grateful for those. You know, I mean, I was lucky when I was last in Paris, I was invited to meet him, and we had a very long, I must say, literary conversation.
What did you talk about, literary?
Well, I mean, he read several of my books, it turns out. So I have a fan in the Élysée Palace. It's very strange, after the attack against me, a lot of people said to me that you lived, it's a miracle. But, you know, I don't believe in miracles. It's very strange to be actually the recipient of a miracle when you don't, in fact, believe in miracles.
34 years ago, after your novel, The Satanic Verses, was published, did you have the same support?
No, I think it was more divided then. You know, there were people who thought that I was a troublemaker and I'd done it to make myself rich and famous.
What changed?
What changed is that I was almost killed, you know, and that, I guess that creates, it clarifies people's thinking.
A trial will soon take place. What do you expect from this trial?
He'll go to jail. I mean, my expectation is that he'll go to jail for a long time.
Will you go to the trial?
I don't know, it depends, you know. At the moment, he's pleading not guilty. I think that's just a holding position. If he pleads guilty, then there isn't actually a trial, there's only a sentencing, you know, at which point it's not necessary for me to give evidence. If there's an actual trial, then I will probably have to give evidence, and that's fine.
What is freedom for you, Salman? What does it mean to you?
You know, just very simple things, just the ability to walk down the street by yourself, you know, and to lead your life with your friends and family and do your work. You know, I mean, that's about it. You know, that at my age, I'm not gonna go climb a mountain, you know. But I do feel that I've been fortunate as a writer most of the time, in that I've been able to make a life doing the only thing in my life that I ever wanted to do, you know. I had no plan B, you know. If the writing hadn't worked out, I had no idea what I would do. So I think if you can spend your life doing the thing you love, that's one definition of freedom.
One of the powers of fiction, Salman, is also that it can take us away from the worst of the present, from the violence of the world. And I have to say, when I read Victory City, I was struck by the laughter, the energy, the sense of joy of this book.
Well, you know, I don't like books that have no sense of humor. And it has been a problem for me with some very great writers. George Eliot, great, one of the greatest writers, but not a lot of jokes. I think in some way, writing comes out the way it comes out. It comes out out of who you are, you know? And my writing, I think, has always had an interest in humor, an interest in entertainment, you know, an interest in the thing about storytelling that makes us want to sit there and listen, you know? I mean, I remember, and there are parts of India where oral storytelling is still very powerful, big audiences, you know. And you realize that for the oral storyteller who has his audience sitting right there, his only job is to keep the audience sitting there, you know. Because if they don't like what he's telling them, they get up and walk away. So the art of the oral story is exactly the art of how to keep the audience listening.
So the story... you tell goes back to the 14th century, 14th century India, and spans more than two centuries. It is the story of a woman, but also the story of the rise and fall of a city. Maybe you can tell us the specificity of this Victory City. Yes. That will be named Bisnaga. How extraordinary was the city supposed to be originally?
Yeah, no, it was, you know, at its height, it was bigger than Paris, bigger than London. You know, it was a great city. One of the things that is strange, if you read the history, is that the empire seems to come out of nowhere. You know, like a decade before, there are these various kingdoms all seeming to be going along quite nicely. And then suddenly, like as if almost overnight, there's this new thing, boom, and it just takes over everything. And you think, where did that come from? And so that was one of the questions I asked myself. How could a city and an empire come into being almost overnight?
But the voice of your main character, Pampa Campana, how did it come to your mind? Where does it come from?
You know, this Pampa is a miracle to me, because I was thinking about this problem, about this empire that is born out of nothing, you know? And I was also thinking about, how do I tell a story that lasts for 250 years? You know, that's difficult, right? And she arrived in my head. I had no idea that she was going to. She arrived in my head and she said, I am the answer to your question.
Seems to me, when you talk about that writing is a little bit like ventriloquism.
Well, if you're lucky, it doesn't always happen. But sometimes the voice comes in your head so powerfully that all you have to do is listen to it.
As a matter of fact, she whispers, just like you, Salman, voices, gestures, memories to the characters she invents. Mm. She's a figure of the novelist, right?
Yes, she is, in a way. She's a figure of the writer, certainly. I don't know if she's a novelist. She's more of a kind of epic poet. I mean, she's more like Homer, you know. She's more like writing the Iliad or the Odyssey than writing a modern novel.
Well, you did write a lot of counter-narratives, and especially about women. It's the Rushdie hero is quite often a heroine. Mm. How is it so?
I think because I had three sisters. I had no brothers and three sisters.
Doesn't make you a woman.
No, it doesn't, but surrounds me with women. I mean, growing up, even in my extended family, aunts and cousins and so on, there were many more women than men. And so I grew up in a way, very kind of female environment. You know, and it means that even to this day, I have many more women friends than men friends. And actually this book, Victory City, has been sitting in my head for a very long time, because when I was very young, when I was 20-something, before I had published a book, I was traveling in South India and I went to the town of Hampi, which is where the ruins of the empire that the book talks about, the Vijayanagar Empire, you know, are there. And I was very impressed, and I thought, why don't I know about these things? You know, it's obviously such an important place, and it's just so interesting. how life was in the 14th and 15th centuries, how, in many ways, how advanced, how culturally rich. You know, it was a time of great poetry in many languages of the South, in Telugu and Kannada in particular. It was a time of philosophy. It was a time of great architecture. And it was a time of great freedom, you know, particularly amongst women. Women had a very high place, you know, that for, there were almost as many schools for girls as there were for boys. Not quite 50-50, but close. And women were in every walk of life, you know. There were women in the army. There were women lawyers. There were women everything, you know. And I thought, how interesting that 700 years ago, the condition of women in India was actually better than it is now. Now in India, there are attacks against women all the time, you know.
Well, precisely, this is the story of a past that has been erased, that has been silenced, a story that nobody is talking about anymore. Why is that so?
Because people's social attitudes are more backward now. but it really was a discovery for me. You know, I think some people think that I made up the feminism in the book, you know. But actually, it's just objectively there in the historical record.
So you are talking about today, as a matter of fact. Are you very optimistic, or are you?
Well, I think, you know, one reason for writing a historical novel is to write about the present day. And in some way, the way in which we see history is colored by where we are today. You know, so what we see in the past is an echo, if you like, of our concerns in the present, you know, and I think that's true of this book. If you talk to people who know me, they will tell you that I'm stupidly optimistic. And when I wrote in my previous novel, Quichotte, I gave that central character an exaggerated version of my optimism, a kind of Candide optimism, you know. I mean, he's a kind of fool. But he's a likable fool in the same way as Candide, you know. And I remember I was at school in England, I was maybe 16 when I first read Candide. And it stayed with me ever since because of this idea, in a way, of optimism being foolish. But I can't get rid of it because I mean, I am by nature quite optimistic.
And as a matter of fact, it's a city where women and men will have almost equal rights. This idea of a new world, a better world, is it enough to believe in it to make it happen?
Well, you know, it goes wrong. That's the thing. I'm not a utopian. You know, I don't believe in utopias. And what happens is that Pampa Kampana kind of creates this city out of magic seeds and out of whispering people's stories into their ears. And she hopes that it's going to be this ideal state. But quite rapidly, the ordinary weaknesses of human beings interfered.
It seems to me that you're telling a backlash story, as a matter of fact, a story of dreams that will not always come true, the story of breakthroughs and multiple backlashes.
Well, this is the history of the human race. We go forward, then we go back.
What are you thinking about?
I'm thinking of every country always. And I mean, I think it seems to me right now we're taking some steps backwards. I mean, when I was younger, I felt that things were moving forward. You know, the world was moving in a good direction, in a direction that I found exciting and optimistic. You know, and it never occurred to me that we would find ourselves in the situation where politicians try and remove books from children's libraries, you know, and where somebody, the quality of leader that's available in this country right now is so poor. You wonder, why is it that people like DeSantis and Trump, how can they even exist and be voted for by large numbers of people? So this is a backsliding moment.
You're making reference to Florida, of course, and DeSantis, where some books were taken off the bookshelves of libraries. How do you fight that?
You fight it by fighting it. You fight it by going to court and by disputing it. In this country, you can use the First Amendment quite powerfully. And you know, I'm involved with various groups like PEN America, like the American Civil Liberties Union, which are taking this to court in Florida right now with the support of local parents, because obviously not all parents think like this. In fact, in one school in Florida, it was one parent objecting to a number of books, which had those books removed. One parent. So, yes, it can be challenged in court, and hopefully will be.
What's endangered here is literature.
Yes, because if you look at the writers who are being banned, they're the best writers in American history. You know, that Toni Morrison, for goodness sake, you know, is being taken out of libraries.
Maybe because these writers, whom you say are very good writers, make it possible for the world to be complex.
Yes. For example, there is a desire on the American right to erase the memory of slavery, to erase the fact that this country was born on, if you like, two original sins. One is the murder of large numbers of the original population, and the other is enslavement of many people from Africa. That's the founding crime of America. And of course, there are people who don't want you to see that. And so the culture war has come to the front, you know. In a way, it shows us that Karl Marx was wrong. Economics is not primary. You know, culture is primary.
And to what extent is the writing of writers, of authors, of literature people more powerful, more important than the other type of stories that are written by politics?
No, of course, I think we're in a kind of war of stories, you know, that certain kinds of politician, authoritarian, populist, propagandist, crowd-pleasing politicians are creating myths of the nation, which allow them to behave badly, you know. I think Brexit was the result of that. It was a result of British politicians creating a mythological England, which would come back into being if only all these unpleasant foreigners could be excluded. You know? And now we see that the damage is colossal, you know, in the United Kingdom. So what can you do as a writer? You can offer counter-narratives, you know, and I think it's important to do that.
Precisely. What is the power of a story? What can it do? What can it bring?
Well, first of all, we have to not overclaim. You know, I mean, there are things that literature can't do. You know, it doesn't very often change the world. Every so often, it has a small part in changing the world. You know, I think, for example, Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel Uncle Tom's Cabin had an enormous effect in this country on affecting people's view of the slavery question. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a story that President Lincoln met Harriet Beecher Stowe and said to her, "Oh, so you're the little woman who started this big war." And there's a sense in which that was true. The book had a colossal impact. Mostly, the way books work is they do change things, but they change things one reader at a time. You know, and the thing is that neither the writer nor the reader knows when that's going to happen, or if it's going to happen.
I'd like you to read a few lines from a poem that appears in Victory City, a very eloquent poem, which is, of course, the very last line.
Okay, yeah. Words are the only victors. What they did or thought or felt no longer exists. Only these words describing those things remain. They will be remembered in the way I have chosen to remember them. Their deeds will only be known in the way they have been set down. They will mean what I wish them to mean. I myself am nothing now. All that remains is this city of words. Words are the only victors.
What do you mean by that? Words are the only victors?
I mean, they last, if you're lucky. I mean, most words don't last, of course. Most words are forgotten, like most of us are forgotten.
What kind of relationship do you have with words? Is it a play, a struggle, a joy as a writer?
It's my life, you know? I mean, there are people who live in images, you know? Picasso lived in images. You know, I live in words, you know? So for me, it's my way of responding to the world I find myself in, the times in which we live, my own experience, everything, you know, the way in which I deal with the world.
But is it hard? Is it a struggle?
Yes, it's very hard. Writing is very hard. the trick of it is not to make it feel hard for the reader.
But where does it come from, this taste for telling stories? Who told you stories when you were a kid?
Well, I think, you know, a lot of writers are born out of readers, you know, and so one of the first things was that I loved reading when I was a kid. And the other was that both my parents, in different ways, were good at telling stories. You know, that my father, who was very knowledgeable about the classics and so on, Indian classics, would tell me his versions, so you know, made into children's versions of, you know, Sinbad the Sailor and, you know, all those stories.
Precisely, which one marked you? Which one struck you as a little boy? Do you remember?
Well, I mean, The Arabian Nights is a huge book, you know, but some of the stories in there, yes. And then there's a Kashmiri collection, which is actually even longer than The 1001 Nights, which is called, in Sanskrit, is called Katha Sarit Sagar. It means the ocean of the streams of story.
Did you believe in these stories at the time?
No, I think, you know, children are very good at having a double view, that you completely believe the story and you also know that it's not true. You can have both feelings passionately at the same time. And I think that's a very good way to approach writing as an adult. You know, of course, you want your reader to be immersed in the text and feel that they're reading about real people having real experiences and real emotions in a real place. But at the same time, they have to be completely aware that it's all made up. So it's this wonderful doubleness of writing that, you know, on the one hand, it's about truth. You know, I mean, I think good literature in whatever form, whether it's fabulist or naturalistic, is about truth. It's about the truth of human nature. It's about who are we? Why do we do what we do? But at the same time, you have to be able to understand that it's a dream, you know, that it's a thing that somebody conjured up out of their head. I like that doubleness.
I don't want to reveal anything, but there are some dreams in Victory City, as there are in many of your novels, actually. What can dream tell us, according to you?
Well, this is a big question, the interpretation of dreams.
Some books have been written about that.
Exactly. Our dreams are our fears and experience and hopes and fantasies all scrambled together, you know, and that is why it's so difficult to interpret them, because they don't follow the rules of our waking life. You know, how does our brain work when we're asleep?
What is your night language? What do you dream of personally?
You know, mostly, particularly when I'm writing books, my dreams are very boring.
Give us an example.
My dreams are I get up and read the newspaper. and I've often thought it's because I'm using so much of my imaginative effort while I'm awake, you know, to make these books, that there's no imaginative effort left for my dreams. It's true that since the attack against me, I've had a number of quite much darker, more violent dreams. But I'm happy to say that they seem to have stopped.
How do you deal with nightmares? How do you soothe them?
You know, you wake up. That's the only way of dealing with the nightmare. But also, it's good to feel that I can understand why it happened, you know, and fairly obvious why it happened. But I'm also very pleased to note that it's not happening anymore.
Never did you, in your career, lose that taste for storytelling. I'm thinking of Harun and the Sea of Stories that suggests that you might have been discouraged at moments.
Well, I mean, there have certainly been bad moments in my life, you know, and that was one of them. This was another. And yeah, for a while, you know, it was hard to imagine what I would write next. You know, but fortunately, it comes back. I mean, I've been doing this for 50 years now. my first novel was actually written in 1973.
And you never stop writing?
No, I mean, what would I do with my day? I mean, I was very surprised, for example, when Philip Roth announced that he was retiring. I thought, how do you do that? As a writer, how do you retire? I mean, Philip had, of course, he'd written like, I don't know, 34, 35 books. And so maybe it's okay. He'd done his work. But what I do think is that I don't feel compelled to write because of a kind of professional reason. I only write if there's something that comes to me to write.
A little more than 10 years ago, your book, Joseph Anton, was published. Why did you need a fictionalizer, a literary double at the time?
Well, because, you know, I was trying to talk about having had to lead a kind of semi-invisible life, you know, and I wanted that book to read like one of my novels. You know, I wanted it to feel novelistic. And I thought the trouble with autobiography in the first person is that the character called I is kind of different than all the other characters. You know, and I thought if I don't use the first person, if the character who is me is at the same grammatical level as all the other characters, then I can write it as if it was a novel.
But when do you actually use the first person? When do you say I? It will be the case, because you've already revealed that your next book will be in the first person about the attempted murder of last year. It will be called The Knife.
Yeah, but it's a different kind of book. I mean, Joseph Anton takes place over more than a decade and actually goes back earlier than that into childhood and so on. So it's much more like a sort of large-scale autobiography. Now, I mean, now I think I have a particular story to tell, you know, of something that happened and to talk about what that was like and what were its consequences and what are its implications. And, you know, it's a different sort of book.
Is it done?
No, I'm doing it.
I'm asking the writer, but also the former president of American Pen that defends free expression and supports persecuted writers all around the world. What do you expect from us, from the people who are watching?
Well, I think two things. One is, as you said, the work I've done with Penn International, America and International Penn and so on. That work has to continue and it needs everybody's support, you know, because actually many writers are in danger in many countries with less defenses than I have, you know, less resources, etc. So we need to pay attention to that. But I have to say that I think in many ways the most lasting damage that the attack against me and my work has done is that it takes people's attention away from my actual writing, you know? And I think the best thing anybody can do who wants to support me is, you know, read my damn books.
You have become some kind of symbol for freedom of speech. I'd like to hear from you from the freedom of imagining, freedom of imagination. How do you deal with that, and how threatened is it?
I'm too old to be threatened. You know, what are they going to do? Stab me? I mean, it's too late for me to be threatened by this nonsense. I think the imagination by its nature is uncontrollable. You know, and that's its value, is that it's not, there are no rules around it, you know.
Merci, Salman.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.